أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Lesson number 297 سورة المزمل We'll do a quick review of the ayat يا أيها المزمل Who is being addressed? Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم Why is he called المزمل? Because he was covered up at that time Why was he covered up? Out of fear What else? Because he was resting What else? He was afraid Because a huge responsibility had been laid on his shoulders, which was to convey to all people. So this is why, Ya Ayyuhal Muzammil, it's a very, what kind of address is it? It's a very affectionate address. What is the command being given to him? قُمِ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا Why is he being told to stand up in prayer at night? Why isn't it sufficient to pray during the day? Already people pray five times a day. Why is it necessary that a person prays at night? It strengthens you. And this strength is very, very necessary for a person who is doing dawah, for a person who is calling people to Allah. Because this work is not easy, it's not simple. You have to face many challenges. And in order to face them, you need inner strength. Because inshallah, we will learn in the next surah that Ya Ayyuhal Muddathir, which was revealed earlier, he was afraid because of the revelation that had come to him. And because no revelation had come for a very long time, this is why he would feel afraid as well, that what's going on, was that really revelation or what was it? Inshallah, we will learn about that later. So over here he's told, قُمِ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا How much is it that he was to pray? How much? نِصْفَهُ أَوْ أُنْقُصْ مِنْهُ قَلِيلًا How much can a person reduce from a half of the night? Up to how much? A third. أَوْ زِدَ عَلَيْهِ Up to two-thirds. And what is it that must be done in قِيَامُ اللَّيْلِ وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا What is tartil? What kind of recitation is it? Summarize what I told you. Tell me, what does it mean by reciting the Qur'an with tartil? First of all, to pronounce correctly, to read correctly, which means to read with giving all of the huruf their haqq, to read with tajweed. Secondly, to recite in a beautiful manner, which means that a person stops at the right places, and then he raises his voice at the right places, lowers his voice at the right places, to recite with understanding, to recite with meaning, because the way of the Prophet ﷺ was that as he would recite, where the ayat would come of mercy, he would ask for mercy. Where the ayat would come of punishment, he would seek refuge against that. So that is only possible if a person recites with understanding and meaning. Anything else included in tartil? To recite slowly, beautifully, so that every word, every letter is clear and distinct. With tadabbur in the ayat. And sometimes, when we're reading fast, then what happens? Or we're trying to reach the end of the ayah, or the end of the page, or the end of the surah, then what happens? We don't think, we don't reflect, we miss out on some huruf and some rules, and we don't give the haqq of every letter, every harakah. So tartil is to not worry about the end of the page, not worry about the end of the surah. Take your time, recite with ease, enjoy the recitation. So وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا Now why is it that Qur'an is to be recited in Qiyam, in the night? Why isn't it that the Prophet ﷺ was told, recite the Qur'an during the day? Because in the night time there are no distractions. And you see over here the ayah which is that Inna nashi'ata al-layli hiya ashaddu wata'an wa aqwa muqila. Two reasons are given. That why is it that worship should be done in the hours of the night? Why is it that you should wake up in the night and then recite the Quran? Because the rising up in the night is hiya ashaddu wata'an. What's the meaning of ashaddu wata'an? It's much better for, much stronger, much more effective when it comes to trampling the nafs, when it comes to controlling the nafs. Now think about it. When a person is getting up in the night, he has to sacrifice his sleep. Before he was lying down, now he has to stand up. He was warm and cozy in bed, then he has to go and make wudu. Isn't it so? And then stand up in the night while other people are asleep. Isn't it so? So it's much more effective when it comes to training the nafs, when it comes to controlling the nafs. And is that necessary for a da'i? Yes, it's very, very important. Because when it comes to da'wah, first of all, what do you have to do? Act on what you know yourself. And for that, you have to be able to control your desires. Isn't it so? And then similarly, when a person is conveying to others, at the same time, you have to be able to control yourself. How? The other person is being harsh to you. You want to be harsh with them as well. But there you have to control yourself. So where do you develop the strength from to control your nafs? The night prayer. You know, for many, many things, for many bad habits, people say that we cannot get rid of them. For many things, people say, I'm just lazy. I can't get over my laziness. Isn't it so? Similarly, there are things that you say you're going to do, and there are things that you say you're not going to do, but then what happens? You end up doing them, you end up not doing them. What's the reason? The nafs needs training. The nafs needs to be controlled. And the best way of training the nafs, the best way of controlling the nafs is standing up in prayer at night. And notice how when you stand in prayer at night, you have to recite the Quran with tartil. That is more of a training as well. Because you can't just read quickly, just to get over the recitation, just to get to the end of the surah. No, you have to read slowly and gradually while thinking and reflecting on the ayat. So that's more of a training. Isn't it so? You have to control your nafs even more. So إِنَّ نَاشِئَةَ اللَّيْلِ هِيَ أَشَدُّ وَطَأً وَأَقْوَ مُقِيلًا. So the night prayer is one of the best ways of reforming oneself. The best way of doing your islah. The second meaning of أَشَدُّ وَطَأً is what? It's most suitable for مُوَطَاط. What does مُوَطَاط mean? Harmony, right? When two things are in line with one another. They are together. They are in line. And the example that I gave you was in the Quran where we learned لِيُوَاطِئُوا عِدَّةَ مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ. So that at the end of the year, the mushrikeen would complete the number of 4 months that were sacred. So it's when two things are in line. And over here, what does it mean? That أَشَدُّ وَطْأً. What is in line? What is in sync? What is together? The tongue and the ear and the heart. So that what a person is reading, he's able to comprehend. What a person is reciting, he's able to understand. He's able to feel it. He's able to take a lesson from it. He's able to reflect on it. And this is possible only at night. What? Such kind of concentration on the Quran is only possible at night. Because at this time, you're not being distracted by other things. So hiya ashaddu wat'an. Now why is this essential for a da'i? That he should spend some time, you know, reciting the Quran in which he's able to fully comprehend and pay attention and concentrate. Why is it necessary? Because if you have not understood yourself, can you convey? No. If you have not been able to absorb something in yourself, can you pass it on to others? You cannot pass it on to others. So the best way of taking in the Quran, the best way absorbing the Quran is how? By reciting the Quran in the night prayer. Without it, you cannot fully comprehend. You cannot concentrate. You cannot contemplate. You cannot benefit. Otherwise, what will happen is that a person will read, he will forget. He will understand temporarily, and then after some time, he will forget. So the only way of solidifying your understanding of the Quran is how? By reading it with concentration. And that is only possible when? In the night. It's not possible during the day. So in order to solidify your understanding, your knowledge of the Quran, what is necessary? That a person must recite it with concentration. And that is only possible in the night. So here, أَشَدُّ وَطْأً. And the second reason that is given in this ayah is وَأَقْوَمُ قِيلًا. And it is most upright in speech, meaning in delivery. And what does it mean by qeel over here? Quranic recitation, first of all. So when a person recites at this time, he is able to recite it in the best possible way because he's able to hear himself. And you might feel that at this time, you know, you're sleepy, you're tired, you want to sleep. But believe me, you try, at this time, you are most fresh. Give it a try. You know, many times there are women who say that because of their children, they're not able to do their lesson during the day. And when do they do it? At Fajr time. Or before Fajr. Somebody was mentioning to me, about this lady who was a convert and she started learning the Quran, and she wouldn't find any time during the day to learn how to recite. So her husband would teach her at the Tahajjud time. At the Tahajjud time. And within a few years, mashallah, she's doing so well. So during the day, you're not as fresh, you're tired. And at that time, early morning, before morning even, last part of the night, is when your senses are most fresh. So that is the time to improve your recitation of the Quran as well. Definitely, it's better if a person has memorized it and he reads whatever he has memorized, because it's easier for you to concentrate. Because when you have a mushaf open in front of you, then you know you're turning the pages and so on and so forth. However, that's also okay that you read from the mushaf in tahajjud prayer. That's also permissible. Can you repeat the surahs? Definitely you can. Once the Prophet ﷺ, he was reciting, and he recited the ayah that we will bring you as a shaheed, and also we will bring them as shaheed, meaning that the Prophet ﷺ will be brought as a witness on the Day of Judgment. So he kept on reciting that ayah over and over and over again. So this is what tartil is, right? That you are reading part of an ayah or a surah or a few ayat repeatedly because you are reflecting on them. You understand? So it's okay for you to repeat the surahs as well. It's best to have a plain mushaf so that you're not distracted by what's written on the side or the translation underneath or the tafsir notes on the side. It's best to have a plain mushaf. Yes, you can say the dua in the middle. And that's exactly what I said right now, that as long as it's in the Arabic language and not in Urdu or English. And you know, this is just like سَبِّحِ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, then you say سُبْحَانَ رَبِّيَ الْأَعْلَى. This is why you're reciting with tawdeel, so that there's a difference between what you say of your own dua and what is of the Quran. And even if you, for example, you don't know how to say it in Arabic, you just say it in your heart. I mean, Allah hears your heart even. So أَقْوَى مُقِيلَ, reciting the Quran in the night is most appropriate, is the best way of making the recitation good, making the recitation sincere. And also أَقْوَى مُقِيلَ, that dua, with regards to dua, it's the best way of making dua, it's the best time, because it will be one that is most sincere. Then another reason is given as to why a person should pray during the night. إِنَّ لَكَ فِي النَّهَارِ سَبْحًا طَوِيلًا, indeed for you by day is prolonged occupation. You have many things to do, endless tasks to perform, extended engagements which never come to an end. And if you get busy in them and think that you will adjust your concentration and your ibadah and all of that in the middle, it will be impossible. So you have to take time out from where? From your own personal time. You see, for every person, especially women, their time is divided between who? Time with their children, time with their spouses, time with their relatives, time with the house. And then there is also a little bit of me time that you get. And that is only when you're sleeping. And sometimes, hardly that as well. Because, you know, mothers who have little children, even when they're sleeping, you know, their sleep is constantly disturbed. However, from this personal time, even the little time that you have, you can take out a little bit of time for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A little bit of time at least to speak with Allah, to worship Him. Because believe me, even as a mother, you cannot remain sane and confident and have a high level of iman and have khushur in salah unless and until you have a strong connection with your Lord. Because many times it happens that mothers, they get swept into family life. So much so that they forget their adhkar even. They forget to recite the Quran even. Tell me, if you think that during the day you're going to get some time in which you're going to open up the dua book and you're going to open up the mushaf and then you're going to read, when will you find that time? You will never find that time. Never ever. So you have to take time out from your personal me time, no matter how little it is, and that will give you the strength to continue. Because if you think about it, so many mothers, what happens to them? They go into depression. Isn't it so? So many mothers, they get frustrated with their children. They get frustrated with their husbands. And they complain of having low iman, weak iman. Why is it so? Because we are not spending time in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember that our purpose of life is what? To worship Allah. And if we don't fulfill that purpose, your life will be empty, it will be meaningless, it will not bring you happiness. No matter how many children you have, no matter how busy you are with them, no matter how many parties you attend, it will not bring you happiness. What will bring you true satisfaction is the worship of Allah. So you have to make time for that. You have to. It's a haqq that your iman demands, that yourself need to fulfill for your sake. So for your own benefit, for your own sanity, for your own iman, make time for yourself. So إِنَّ لَكَ فِي النَّهَارِ سَبْحًا طَوِيلًا. There is a lot of occupation during the day, so you have to take time out during the night. And it's just about making some changes in your day, in your routine, and everything falls in place very quickly. Because sometimes, you know, we think that, oh, the children will wake up, oh, they have to go to school, I have to cook, I have to do this. Everything can be done. Everything can be done. Think about it, you're coming here right now, isn't it? And you're coming for how long? So many hours of a day. If you can make time for this class, you can also take time out 15 minutes just before Fajr even. Start with that, 15 minutes before Fajr. And inshallah, that will put so much barakah in your day. That will give you so much energy throughout the day. And these days, alhamdulillah, by the time Fajr begins, around 6:15, you can easily wake up half an hour before. Start off with 2 rakah, start off with 4 rakah, how much ever is possible. But make the intention. Start something. This is very true, that you just have to train your body and you will actually start waking up yourself. She's giving an example of this boy who goes for Fajr regularly, and somebody asked him that, how do you wake up? He said, well, before I used to wake up with the alarm clock, but now I don't have to even do that. Because your body gets used to waking up at a time that you regularly wake up at. And even if you don't get out of bed, you will be awake.
At night time when you wake up, you're all alone, so it makes you more humble.
So the worship of the night time is not comparable with the worship of the day. And it's about making up your mind that I have to do this. It's about making up your mind. And when you make up your mind, you make a firm intention, Allah even gives you the tawfiq.
My mother, she's deaf. And it's been many, many years before even her marriage. But I have never seen her skipping tahajjud, like, ever. And she's the first one to get up, and she's the one who wakes us up. And at times she tells us that, today someone has woke me up. I mean, I can feel that someone has moved me. Subhanallah.
Yes. That's, you know, we think we're so busy, we have to go to school, we have to go to work, and we have to do this and that. This is why, you know, for us it's not necessary. Allah knows what situation we're in. But if you think about it, the people, just the previous generation, even they lived extremely busy lives. Like the stories that my grandmother tells me, the amount of children she's raised, not just her children, but the rest of family members as well, looking after them, cooking for them, cleaning for them, doing their laundry, everything by hand. And still they're getting up for Fajr, they're getting up for Tahajjud. No excuses, it's about making up your mind. This is the quality time that you spend with your Lord. And it doesn't have to be hours and hours. I mean, it's best if it is. However, if you start off with even 15 minutes, if you start off with half an hour even, that is also good. We learn from a hadith, which is reported in Ibn Khuzaymah, that the Prophet ﷺ said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِقِيَامِ اللَّيْلِ. عَلَيْكُمْ بِقِيَامِ اللَّيْلِ. Meaning, make sure you pray قِيَامُ اللَّيْلِ. فَإِنَّهُ دَأْبُ الصَّالِحِينَ قَبْلَكُمْ. Because it was the habit of the righteous people before you. This has always been the habit of who? The righteous people before you. Dawood alayhi salam, he used to pray Qiyamul Layl as well. وَهُوَ قُرْبَةٌ لَكُمْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ. And it is a means of drawing closer to who? To your Lord. This is how you get closer to your Lord. Because this is when you recite His words, and this is when you make dua to Him. وَمَكْفَرَةٌ لِلسَّيِّئَاتِ. And this is a means of expiation of sins as well. Forgiveness of sins. وَمَنْهَاتٌ عَنِ الْإِثْنِ. And this is a means of stopping you from committing sin as well. There are many, many habits that we want to get rid of. Things that we want to stop. Good things we want to start. But we're not able to. We don't find the strength. We fall weak. We forget again and again. So where do you get that strength from? قِيَامُ اللَّيْلِ. وَمَنْهَاتٌ عَنِ الْإِثْمِ. It will prevent you from committing sin. So over here, we learn, إِنَّ نَاشِئَةَ اللَّيْلِ هِيَ أَشَدُّ وَطْءًا وَأَقْوَمُ قِيلًا. إِنَّ لَكَ فِي النَّهَارِ سَبْحًا طويلا وانكر اسم ربك وتبتل إليه تبتيلا. And remember the name of your Lord and devote yourself to Him with complete devotion. What does it mean by this? تبتل إليه تبتيلا. What does this mean? Yes, that the time that you have taken out to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then cut yourself off from the rest of the world. At that time, be fully devoted. Be fully devoted. Don't think about other things. Don't be worried and concerned about others. And this is only possible when? In the night time. Because during the day, there are too many distractions, too many things to do. So tabattal ilayhi tabtila can only be done when? In the night. And tabattal ilayhi tabtila, this is also in general terms, that a person must take out time to devote himself completely to his Lord. There must be some moments of the day, some hours of the day, when a person is devoted to his Lord only and he's not concerned about other things. You know, think about it. Any work that you do, if you want to do it properly, then what do you have to do? You have to give it full concentration. Full concentration. If you're trying to multitask, if you're trying to do multiple things at a time, then what will happen? You will get nothing done at the end. Or you will get many things done at the end, but no quality in any. Isn't it so? So, there must be some time in which a person is exclusively worshipping Allah. Doing nothing else but that. Because many times what happens? We are doing dhikr and we are washing dishes. We are reading our adhkar and we are cleaning at the same time. Yes, that's very good. Your tongue should always be busy in the dhikr of Allah. However, can you concentrate as much on the dhikr? Can you? No, you can't. So, there has to be some time in which a person is fully devoted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَتَبَتَّلْ إِلَيْهِ تَبْتِيلًا. And this also means that when you have completed your tasks, when you've completed your work, then busy yourself in His obedience and His worship. This is just as we learned, فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ. That when you have become free from your work, then فَانْصَبْ. Then stand up and be fixed for the worship of Allah. Don't think about other things. Who is your Lord? رَبُّ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّهُ فَاتَّخِذْهُ وَكِيلًا. He is the Lord of the East and the West. There is no deity except Him. So take Him as your wakil. Take Him as your disposer of affairs. Hand over your problems to Him. Seek His help. Connect with Him. Ask Him for His help. And when will that be? Through the prayer. Recitation of these ayat. Would say to the Prophet ﷺ, what kind of words? Words of takdeeb, of denial, words of adha, such words that would hurt him. So be patient over what they say, wahjurhum, and avoid them, hajran jamila, with gracious avoidance. This is one of the earliest teachings that were given to the Prophet ﷺ, because remember, the surah was revealed at a very early period. And what is it that he's being told to do? Have sabr. Be patient over what they say and leave them, avoid them with gracious avoidance. Uhjurhum is from the root letters? Hajimra. Hijra is from the same root as well. What does hajar mean? To leave something. To go away from there. To abandon something. Mahjur. What is mahjur? That which has been left, that which has been abandoned. So wahjurhum, avoid them, part with them. How? Hajran jamila, in a gracious manner, in a beautiful manner. How does a person leave the other in a beautiful manner? Without making them realize. How else? Okay, leaving in good terms, but if they are angry at you, then without responding in a negative way. So for example, if they're arguing with you, without arguing. If they are saying foul words to you, without saying anything harsh to them. Just ignore. وَهْجُرْهُمْ هَجْرًا جَمِيلًا. Just leave in a beautiful manner. This is just like we have learned that وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. Without saying any offensive words. وَهْجُرْهُمْ هَجْرًا جَمِيلًا. وَذَرْنِي, and leave me. وَالْمُكَذِّبِينَ, and those who deny. It doesn't mean leave me, but what it means is leave me to deal with. Leave me to deal with who? الْمُكَذِّبِينَ, the deniers. Meaning, leave this matter to me. You don't worry about it. I will deal with who? Al-mukathibin, those who deny you. And who are these people who deny you? Ulin na'mati, those of ease in life, possessors of na'mah. What does na'mah mean? Comfort, blessing, ease, in particular, life of ease. And life of ease, how is that possible? With affluence, with wealth, with enjoyment, with comfort. So these mukaddibeen who are living a life of ease, you leave me to deal with them. You part with them, don't bother with them, don't fight with them, don't argue with them. And you leave their matter to me, I will deal with them. وَمَهِّلْهُمْ قَلِيلًا And allow them respite a little. مَهِّل مَهِّل from تَمْهِيل ميم هَا لَام And تَمْهِيل is to give مُهْلَة. And what does مُهْلَة mean? Respite. So give respite, delay, for how long? قَلِيلًا For a little time. Meaning give them some time. Don't become aggressive, don't become angry, don't become vengeful immediately, but rather give some time. So those people who are denying you, if they deny you, don't start praying against them immediately. Don't start becoming angry with them immediately, but rather give them some time. Why give them some time? So that they can realize. So that they can see the truth and they can eventually believe. And if you think about it, was this tamheel necessary? Yes. Because there were so many people who did not embrace Islam immediately. They embraced Islam much later. And if this muhla was not given, then what would happen? They would not embrace Islam. Like for example, Umar radiallahu anhu. Mahilhum qalila, that is how he was able to embrace Islam. Similarly, Khalid ibn Walid. Similarly, Amr ibn al-As. So many companions who were great opponents of Islam initially at the beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says concerning them, مَهِّلْهُمْ قَلِيلًا Give them some time, very soon they will realize, very soon they will accept. So what does it show? That a da'i must have sabr. Sabr in listening to what the people say to him. Sabr in dealing with the enmity of others as well. That no matter how great their enmity is, you must give them some space, you must give them some time to think, some time to realize. Because this is the work of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person is calling others to Allah, he is working for whose sake? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in whose hands is guidance as well? Allah. And Allah knows when to give guidance to who. So it's quite possible these people don't believe now, but tomorrow they will. So no matter how great their enmity is, don't become vengeful against them. Don't start praying against them. Just wait a little bit. مَهِلْهُمْ قَلِيلًا Because think about it, you talk to someone, they respond very harshly, you get hurt. Isn't it? And when you see that they're not changing, they're not listening, what do you think? That's it, they're never going to change. Don't think like this. Allah can change their heart any moment. Be hopeful. Keep praying for them. مَهِلْهُمْ قَلِيلًا And secondly, مَهِلْهُمْ قَلِيلًا is also understood as ignore them for some time, give them respite, and very soon Allah will punish them. And this happened, that there were people who did not take benefit of the time they were given, and eventually the punishment of Allah descended on them. إِنَّ لَدَيْنَا Indeed with us are أَنْكَالًا shackles, وَجَحِيمًا and a burning fire. Meaning we have for such deniers in the hereafter ankal and jahim. Ankal is a plural of nickel. And nickel is used for fetters, shackles, chains, in particular those that are used to bind animals. So for example, you may have seen a cow whose foot is shackled. Or for example, a donkey whose neck is shackled. So the fetters, the shackles that are used to bind animals, they are known as ankal. And they're much more stronger, much more rough, compared to the shackles that are used for prisoners. Isn't it so? They're much more stronger and much more rough and crude. So, إِنَّ لَدَيْنَا أَنْكَالًا Heavy shackles, وَجَحِيمًا A scorching fire, a raging hellfire. Moreover, وَطَعَامًا ذَا غُصَّةٍ And food that chokes, وَعَذَابًا أَلِيمًا And a painful punishment. We have such food for them that is ذَا غُصَّةٍ. What does it mean by ذَا غُصَّةٍ? This is from the root letters غَيْن صَاد صَاد. And غَصَّ يَغُصُّ is that which chokes, that which gets stuck, which gets congested in the throat. It's also used for a lump in the throat, that which gets stuck in the throat. So ذَا غُصَّةٍ, it is such food whose characteristic is that it gets stuck in the throat and it's not easily swallowable. The characteristic of the food of hellfire is what? That it gets stuck in the throat. It's not easy to swallow it. You know, sometimes you're having something extremely dry, and what happens? It gets stuck in the throat. For example, it's very flaky or dry. Or for example, it's a piece of a bone. Gets stuck in your throat. So, وَطَعَامًا ذَا غُصَّةٍ. This is the food of hellfire that is prepared for them. Which food is this? We have learned about it in the Quran. زقوم, غسلين, thorns. ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع. So طعاما ذا غصة وعذابا أليما, and a painful punishment. In Surah Luqman, Ayah 24, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نمتعهم قليلا ثم نضطرهم إلى عذاب غليظ. We grant them enjoyment for a little, and then we will force them to a massive punishment. So right now, let them be. They're opposing you, let them be. It's okay, give them time. You be patient, you keep doing your work, you keep building your strength, and Allah will deal with these people. We'll listen to the recitation.
وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا يَقُولُونَ وَاهْجُرْهُمْ هَجْرًا جَمِيلًا وَذَرْنِي وَالْمُكَذِّبِينَ أُولِي النَّعْمَةِ وَمَهِّلْهُمْ قَلِيلًا إِنَّ لَدَيْنَا